This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Hey, everybody. This is Razib Khan with the Unsupervised Learning Podcast. I am here with my friend Colin, and we're here to talk about China. Colin, can you introduce yourself to the listeners out there and just tell us, your general... I mean, the reason why I'm talking to you about China as opposed to just some random person or some guy who studies Chinese history.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Razib. It's good to be on the show. Longtime fan of yours. So the reason, I guess, you would want to talk to me is I have, unlike a lot of academics, I have real world experience living and working in the Greater China region, which includes mainland China and Taiwan, or the Republic of China. And I've also spent time with other ethnic Chinese populations in East and Southeast Asia, such as in Singapore. That has to do a lot with my job. I'm a technologist. I'm a technology manager. So I've worked as an expat in the region, not just in the Chinese space, but also in Japan. So all my in-laws are Chinese. I speak Mandarin at an intermediate level. That includes reading and writing at an intermediate level. So I think I have a lot to bring to the table as far as practical real-world knowledge as compared to just theoretical.
Well, I mean, give us some dates. Give us some time, sure. Because, you know, that matters so much in understanding China with that part of the world, which is changing so fast.
Yeah, so the first time, actually, I lived in mainland China was in 1999 as an undergraduate. I studied that in Shanghai. At that time, it was called Foreign Language University, Shanghai Waikouyu Dashui. And I was an exchange student studying Mandarin in Shanghai, which was quite a bit different from what it is today. China had been opening up for almost 20 years. However, they hadn't joined the World Trade Organization yet. They had at that point. It was under Clinton. But they had just joined a few years before. There were hardly any foreigners on the street at that time. In fact, most of the people in Shanghai were not even from outside the province as they are now. Waidiren. They were locals, Bundiren. And you can hear Shanghainese on the street everywhere, unlike today. Where you only hear it in some local neighborhood spoken mostly purely by older people.
So you're talking 22 years ago. In 22 years, there's been a total demographic shift in Shanghai.
Oh, absolutely. When I went back to Shanghai, I went back to Shanghai a few times, but I moved back to work full time for about a year and a half in the early 2010s. I worked for a medium-sized American multinational. My office was all Chinese. It was a completely different place. I barely recognized Shanghai at that point. This is unlike, I mean, I spent some time in Europe too. But when I go back there, everything looks pretty much the same. It doesn't matter if it's been a decade or two decades. I can navigate it very easily based on memory. Shanghai was not like that. Radically changed. You hardly hear Shanghainese anywhere. You heard all kinds of dialects of Chinese, northern accented Mandarin. New buildings, new construction, all over the place. I lived in Pudong, which was at that time it was a lot of factories over there in 1999, and they were just building up the financial district. Now the financial district is completely built out. Not many factories or fields anymore. It looks like almost like an American suburb. So you have Puxi, which is the main part of Shanghai, and Pudong, which is across the river, across the Yangtze. And then on that side, that's where the financial capital is. That's where you see the Pearl Tower, those pictures of Shanghai. That's actually in Pudong. This is completely Pudong. Pudong and the Pearl Tower existed in 1999 too, but there wasn't much beyond that. Now it's maglev trains to the new international airport. All types of infrastructure has been built.
Well, so I was just checking the references, and it's seems like its official population went from 16 million to 24 million in the 20 years that you're talking about. Well, now to that from then, and so that's 8 million people. That's probably an underestimate. 8 million people is a. I mean, that's going to be a huge. I mean, that's New York City.
Yeah. Well, 8 million, yeah, you're exactly right. It is an underestimate because there are many people who live and work in Shanghai every day who are not legally allowed to be there. Internally in China, you need a hukou, which is basically like a housing permit to live somewhere. And it's not easy to get a hukou to live in large cities if you're from a rural area, especially if you're not educated, you don't work for a formal company. And so, but those people are the people who are really building this new China. They come from rural areas. They work construction. They work, as cooks, waiters, any type of low-level service job. They cut hair, etc. They build modern China. And usually what happens is they come from these places, the surrounding provinces, by themselves, because without a hukou, their children, it varies by city, but in most cities, it's very hard for them to get their children educated or register in any type of school. They don't have health care in the local area, etc. So they come alone. They leave their children with relatives back home.
Let me ask you, Colin, did you, when you were there in 99, did you feel Shanghai was a third world city, or could you already feel that it was a modern city? I know that there was a lot of development, but just tell me about what it felt like. Were there people with bicycles still? I just want to get a general sense of the feel because, you know, we see a lot of images of urban China now, and obviously there's no bicycles.
Yeah, no, there's no bicycles, and not many. It's very, very, even in rural areas, there's not many bicycles anymore. At that time in Shanghai, I would say the transition was just starting to where you saw bicycles, but not like the images you would see from Tiananmen Square type time period, 89. That time period, you saw a lot of bicycles, etc. That was fading out. What you saw then in Shanghai was it seemed that everybody had the same model Volkswagen. And I can't recall the model off the top of my head, but it seemed that it was everywhere. It was almost ubiquitous. And and you would see, I would say it was still a developing country. A lot of the tributaries, creeks, etc., running through the river running through the city were very dirty. You could smell the pollution, chemicals in them. There's historic flooding in Shanghai during the rainy season. It's still flooding now, but back then it was far worse. Like I'm talking about water up to your ankles. This might be more reminiscent of something you would think of in, the stereotype that you would see in South Asia. This was very common in China as well at the time. So people would walk around their pajamas. That was during the rainy season, that was a tradition in Shanghai, which the government banned because they said it was basically backward and not becoming of a modern city. So this image of people walking around their pajamas with their pants rolled up and wearing sandals, walking through dirty water, that is not something you see anymore. And that was not something I saw in the early 2010s at all. Mm-hmm. But 1999, that was everywhere.
And when was the last time you went back to China?
The last time I went back was in 2017. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm just getting a sense, you know, for the science listeners, it's like, okay, you got these time points in the late 90s, early 2000s, you got like the early teens, and then you've been back in 2017. I'm asking this because, we've talked before, Colin, we know each other. I feel like in ecology or, in science, we say you have a temporal transect. Like you sampled China as it's been developing over the last generation, basically, and you've seen the changes, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
And so I want to know, in terms of the Chinese sense of the foreigner, of the outsider, You know, can you tell us? I mean, so I have some intuitions on how it might have changed, but tell us your impressions of how it changed.
I think, you know, okay. So when I first went there in 1999, I'll give you this will give you a good sample as far as being a student. Most of the foreign students at my university were Japanese, and then second largest population was Korean. Third were German, then French. Americans, there were three of us. The other two were typical white Americans. One was from the Midwest, I remember. And myself, the only African American, the only black person that I knew of as a foreign student on the campus at that time. And so the stereotype, when Chinese people usually said foreigner, la wai, they were talking about white people. And most of those la wai were foreign business people, sometimes English teachers. Now it's changed. So I think a lot of the major international institutions, there's far more Western people. There's far more Africans as well. There's South Asians. La Wai doesn't necessarily mean a white person anymore. Chinese get much more specific. They will say if the person is black or white, etc. I think that the prestige of being a foreigner has declined quite a bit. Chinese used to be in Shanghai, used to be very curious. I could go out to a bar or nightclub as a student and people would just pay for my drinks. They'd just be happy to sit with a foreigner who could chat in just a little, like, you know, we're talking about elementary school level Chinese at that time. And they'd just be happy to sit with them and talk. That was that rare and it was, you know, unusual. And sometimes we're even talking about officials or children of officials, Communist Party officials or military who would do this, you know. That doesn't happen anymore. Now I feel that in the last few years, being a Western in China, people got more sophisticated. So if you're an English teacher, you don't really have much prestige at all. A lot of times people will say, you know, they'll make negative remarks about this person not being able to make it in their own society, just coming to China to be lazy or to chase women, etc., get drunk. They really pay attention to what your job is and what you're doing there, what you're bringing to China, what you're adding, besides just a foreign face. It used to be that in China, you could get a job, especially as a white person, mm-hmm. where we call them white monkey jobs, where you literally white monkey jobs, where you would the company, a smaller Chinese company I wanted to export to a Western countries. Would hire a white person, often an English teacher, and just have them sit in the boardroom to look more international, like they mm-hmm. had a Western consultant. Mm-hmm. These things are not very common anymore either. I'm not saying they don't happen, but it's far less than it used to be. Even in cities like Chengdu out in Sichuan, which I spent about 6 months out there, even out there, people, although they see less foreigners, they're not... when I say foreigners, they see less Westerners. They are not as enamored with them as they used to be. I think they feel that China has caught up and mm-hmm. is becoming equal.
What when were you in Chengdu again?
In Chengdu, I was so the company I work for, I was sent out to Chengdu because we had a office out there, a small one. And so that was around 2012, 2013. Yeah. So I was going back and forth between Shanghai and Chengdu at that time.
Okay. So already in, I mean, because 2012, I mean, you know, in China years, yeah, that's kind of a while ago, right? You know?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So already you're getting a sense. You know, we've talked about this before, but, you know, I want you to kind of address it real quickly. You know, like racism in China, you know, you don't need to belabor mm-hmm. the point. Like you have your own opinions, your own perceptions.
Sure.
Can you talk about that really quickly? Because, you know, some of us hear a little bit about it.
Sure. I would say the briefest way I could state it is that there is definitely racism in China. However, let's put it this way. Compared to the West, this is a good comparison. When I lived in Europe, I was warned living in Switzerland, not to go east of East Germany by myself in Europe. Eastern Germany, Poland, etc. Don't go these places by myself because skinheads hang out at train stations, etc. You might be harassed or physically attacked in some countries if you don't know where you are. In China, The idea of attacking or physically or any kind of hostility, physical hostility toward foreigners is not common at all. I didn't meet any foreign people who felt a threat to their safety when I was there, including myself. I walked everywhere, poor neighborhoods to the wealthiest areas. I never had issues. The difference is this. I think race in China is related to classism, and classism does definitely exist even among Chinese people. Communism did not erase that. It still very much exists. And what Chinese people tend to think in general, at least in my impression from my in-laws, my friends, etc., is that Western people, on average, white people typically, are better educated and wealthier and built nice countries. Darker people tend to be less educated, maybe more wild, maybe more disorganized, or as people would say, chaotic. And don't build nice countries. And so I would say that's where the stereotypes lie. It's somewhat based in classism. And in China, it's somewhat similar, where if you're from a rural area, you're not educated, you're darker because you work outside, you're seen as lower class. So they take these stereotypes that they have and expand it out to the world, because most Chinese people don't have a strong association with foreign people. There's just not that many foreign people in China as a whole. Chinese people now in cities see foreigners, but that doesn't mean they necessarily talk to them or have any interaction with them, any deep interaction. So the difference, I think, is that if you can show that you are educated and you are coming to China for good reasons, most Chinese people will get over whatever racial hangups they have, or you can negotiate it. It's not deep-seated hatred as you would see in a lot of Western countries. Yeah, that's the difference.
Okay, so I want to explore this issue with race and class a little bit, because, you know, we're American.
Yeah.
This is the time. You're saying class is a very, very persistent thing in China. So, you know, we read about the Cultural Revolution and the communism and all this stuff. But I know from Greg Clark's work that there's actually a fair amount of evidence that, bureaucratic elite families in late imperial China are well overrepresented in the Communist Party, in the elites. Do you have any sense, any intuition from talking to people, like how, if this is still working in terms of, you know, the people come from really well-educated backgrounds? And I guess there's a certain way of talking that indicates that you are a professional managerial class in the United States. How does that work in Mandarin? I'm assuming that there's a way that, I mean, aside from regional accents aside, can you just tell that someone's from a, you know, proletariat or peasant background just by the way they're speaking?
Well, sure. I mean, you know, you have the accent thing. Usually the worse your Mandarin is, the less standard it is. And standard meaning the less it sounds like people on television, which is almost always standard Mandarin in China. That's something, but that says a lot. However, more so, Chinese use a lot of four character phrases called Cheng Yu, and the Cheng Yu, these are sayings that we use, like let sleeping dogs lie, like in English would be one, for example. In Chinese, they have many. And so I think the more complex the Cheng Yu is, at least that's been my impression, and I think that's the impression of talk when I've talked to Chinese people about this, the more complex it is, the more they quote this, the more they quote the Chinese classics, the more educated they are. And that's a telltale sign that someone is closer to an elite. I'm not sure that translates as well to a lot of the younger generation. I'm thinking, when I say this, I'm thinking about people over 50. I think that's very true. Younger people, I think it almost seems to me that a lot of younger people face is a bit important thing. So you can tell somebody's status by what they're showing you, like their car, their watch, their clothes, how they carry themselves, their manners at the dinner table. etc. Face is very important in East Asian culture in general, especially, you know, originated probably in Chinese culture. And so what people think about you matters. And unlike in the US, I would say, where you might not be able to tell, I know some people have multiples of millions of dollars in assets. And I can think of a couple of them. You wouldn't be able to tell that until you saw where they lived. You can even tell that by their car. In China, that is not the case. That's very rarely ever the case. You will know.
Well, so the irony of what you're telling me is America, the capitalist paradise, we underemphasize, which is true, we underemphasize in some ways. So one of the reasons Donald J. Trump was not very popular among the intelligentsia was because he was blingy and crass.
Yes.
there was an aspect to him that was garish, and our cultural elites, they're not garish. They have beautiful marble countertops from their local stonemason, who himself went to Wesleyan. He has his trust fund, but you know, he's really gotten into masonry, and that's his bliss. So in China, it's not like that. Like in China, this communist, quote unquote, communist country, you are saying that class is extremely important now, and it's visible and it's surfaced, and people, they kind of show it.
They definitely show it. And actually, in the last decade, the Communist Party has done a lot to try to stop people from showing this on social media, because the gap between rich and poor, the Gini coefficient in China, is getting really bad. And the party is aware of this. They pay careful attention to social opinion. And, people showing, you have pictures on social media like a decade ago of people setting money on fire so that they could just do it, that they had so much money they didn't have to care. People saying that they are so-and-so's son from the party, high-ranking party official, taking pictures with Porsches. You don't see that as much anymore. That stuff has been clamped down on because it's causing class animosity, right? And you can see that online. So, yeah, I think Americans... Americans like money, clearly. This is a very capitalist society. From a Western perspective, we're definitely skewed to the tail as far as our level of capitalism. But the thing about Americans is, like you said, we don't like to overtly show it. We actually don't like to even talk about money that much. In China, people are always talking about how to make money, how to invest, what houses to buy, what properties, stocks, etc. This isn't just for mainland China. This is Chinese culture, I believe. Every place I've been with ethnic Chinese people, it's pretty much the same. Communism took over in 1949. I don't think that's enough to change the previous several thousand years of history. It's just not enough time.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so class is a really big thing. Your contention, Colin, is that Chinese racism is actually rooted in class. So, I'm actually curious. So I've actually done a little bit of readings of the ideas of race in late imperial, early Republican China. And, the more biologistic, understandings of race were actually, pretty much imported. I mean, people have some folk intuitions of biology and race, but, modern scientific understandings of race and racism, scientific racism, was actually imported, by progressive intellectuals in early Republican China in the early 20th century, and it was actually opposed by Confucian traditionalists, for whom biology was underemphasized. I mean, you could almost say that they're blank slates, but I mean, this is reducing ancient categories into modern systems. But I mean, what do you think that still holds in some ways in China? Because that's what it sounds like to me.
I think there is something to that. And, when you just said that about Confucianism and blank slates, I thought about the Soviet man. I'm not comparing Confucianist thinking to Marxism. But I think it's a similar vein to where most Chinese people that I know, like I said, including my in-laws, they believe if you work hard enough, you can accomplish great things. They don't believe so much. I think, you know, a lot of times as far as biological, you know, we talk about nature nurture debate and nature, and you know, you see these things in America around, of course, you know this very well, that around issues such as IQ, etc. This is very sensitive in the U.S. and the American dream. Part of that is if you come here and work hard enough, you can do what you want. You can accomplish things. You know, you can accomplish the American dream. But I honestly believe that Chinese people believe this even more than Americans do. They don't talk much about aptitude for things. They just think if you're not accomplishing something, then you need to work harder. And I think this comes from Confucianism, that anybody can be molded into an ideal citizen, educated person by hard work. And the correct moral attitude. So I think most Chinese people still kind of believe that. And so, you know, I'm a black guy, right? And I'm obviously black. In China, most people think on the street, I'm definitely African, okay? And so I was a manager at a company in China where all the junior staff were Chinese. I never had any issue with any of them. Mm-hmm. And as far as race, that I could tell. And I think mm-hmm. a lot of this was, I came in, I was known as an American. I showed myself as capable. My superiors showed confidence in me. And so people are like, okay, well, maybe they have some stereotype about black people or Africans, etc. But in their mind, it's like, okay, well, this guy clearly has demonstrated something. I don't know about all black people, but as far as him, he seems to be a person that we can respect. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so you have experience, again, like, let's go to, like, you have experience interacting with people. I mean, especially obviously in the early teens, but, you know, in the late 90s and then also more recently. And is this an invariant in your perception, or do you think things have changed a little bit at all in China as they become more open to the outside and more worldly, it sounds like?
Well, the only thing I will say that's changed is, and it's hard to gauge this because, like I said, I haven't been back to China for a little while now. Actually, we're talking about going next year. If the COVID stuff clears up and China actually opens up again to foreign travel. Mm-hmm. Right now it's closed pretty much. If you didn't have a residency permit, you can't get in. I think the only thing that's changed is now there is more nationalism, and maybe there is more just general anti-foreign sentiment or suspicion in the general society that I'm seeing. But this is mostly online, so it's very hard to gauge if that is representative of anything in the street. Usually what I see online is much more it's much more extreme than what you would find on the street. Most people are apolitical in China for obvious reasons. They really don't have control over their government, so they focus on things, and they're pragmatic people. They focus on things that they can do, like mm-hmm. improve their standard of living by working or educating themselves, etc. So a lot of mm-hmm. people don't necessarily have firm political opinions per se, or and mm-hmm. are not expected to, unlike in the U.S. where you have people spouting off various opinions that it's very clear they've never had any deep thought about. In China, it's more that they really don't have a lot of thought about it, and most people don't want to talk about it either. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I am seeing more nationalism online in the Chinese mm-hmm. social media space, in Weibo, for example. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And this is mainly directed toward Western people. But I've also seen some toward Africans, in that people are saying that they get too much funding from China, development funding, as well as educational benefits, scholarships, etc. And that could go to Chinese people, for example. Mm-hmm. Things like this, things that these are things that I didn't really see or hear much when I was living in China or a decade ago. But yeah,
It sounds like China's becoming a modern, developed country with the complaints that they have now.
Yeah, right. No, that I think that's true. I think that people are getting comfortable now. There's a pretty stable middle class. And even in the rural areas where, you know, there's still a lot of poverty, their standard of living has increased quite a bit since 1979, when China looked a lot more like North Korea. Well, probably better than North Korea at that time even, but still, it looked much more like that than it does like a middle-income country now. So I think people are getting, as they have their basic needs met, you know, Maslow hierarchy of needs, they're now starting to look at other things. Why are we spending so much money on space, for example, like space travel, et cetera, when we have, you know, places where, you know, I have flooding, for example. Mm-hmm. I saw that complaint online, which was removed pretty quickly.
So, are you talking about like on WeChat or like what social media are you on?
Weibo, which is more like a Chinese Twitter, I guess.
Yeah, let me ask you just like a question about linguistics. So I know there's standard Mandarin Chinese, the common tongue or whatever they call it. Mm-hmm. And so let me just be clear for the listener. Chinese is a unified written language. Well, I mean, there's the one in Taiwan, and then, you know, the classical and whatnot. But let's just go with the idea that Chinese is a unified language with the characters, whatever your dialect. Then there's like dialects like Cantonese, which are unintelligible to standard Mandarin. And then within Mandarin itself, there are local Mandarin dialects. So in Sichuan, they speak Sichuan Mandarin dialect. And then in northern China, like, you know, Hunan or Hainan, they speak that dialect. And then there's the standard Chinese, which, you know, traditionally has been, I think, based now for a couple of centuries on the Beijing dialect, or at least a century on the Beijing dialect.
Roughly.
Let's just say what emerged in Beijing, because Beijing itself can be a microcosm of China as a whole. So it's not really necessarily representative of the rest of the North China, very far North China. So I think, like, I've seen estimates that 70% of Chinese are fluent in standard Mandarin, and they want to get that up to, and so this is just like speaking, because literacy is supposedly higher, they want to get that up to like 90-95% within a generation, maybe within like the 2030, actually, because some of the articles that I'm seeing are from like 2011. How realistic do you think it is? How realistic are numbers like 75% no standard Mandarin? Just your impression, because, you know, look, I mean, statistics out of China, you got to be careful.
Yeah, I don't have a particularly great read on this, but I would say this. 75% doesn't seem shocking to me when I think about the fact that I've been in rural areas where people were telling me they were speaking Mandarin and I could barely understand anything they were saying. And even the Chinese people with me had a hard time understanding anything they were saying. And these rural Chinese people were telling me I spoke better Mandarin than them, and they weren't saying it to give me face. It was literally true. I think that basically it works like this. Before the communists took over, a large percentage of the Chinese population didn't have formal education. And when they did start formal education, just a few years later, they basically standardized Mandarin as the language that they wanted to use, because most people spoke something that was a dialect of specifically Mandarin, like a sub-dialect. In the greater Chinese plain, it's pretty flat. That's where Mandarin comes from. And so the majority of the population, or a large percentage of the population, lived there and could speak something like Mandarin. And so that's what they decided on. And so I think people who are 50 to 60 years old and younger usually speak Mandarin fairly well. I'm not saying they sound like they're highly educated, but they can speak at a, let's say, maybe a 10th grade level, something like this, 9th grade level. And so you have regions in China where you have the border regions, especially, have a lot of minority groups. And until recently, they could learn their own local language. If that was Korean, if that was Tibetan, if that was Uyghur, if whatever that was, they could learn that in elementary school. And they learn Mandarin later. And so their Mandarin is stereotypically usually poor. and heavily accented. And I've met people like this. And then you have people like in my wife's family who are from Guangdong, which borders Hong Kong, where they speak Cantonese. There are other dialects in Guangdong as well, but Cantonese is the main one. And, you know, some of the my mother-in-law, who's in her 70s now, speaks fluent Mandarin, but her older brother is in his 80s, doesn't speak Mandarin well, for example. And so, you know, I think it is true that maybe it could be as high as 75% don't speak Mandarin fluently, especially in rural areas, especially older people, especially minorities. Keep in mind that China is 1.4 billion people, a little over 100 million are minorities. And I think what the Chinese government has done, and it's got a lot of complaints, even from within China, is that they made it very difficult to use dialect in the mass media. It's very limited, the amount you can use on the radio or the television. Almost everything, if an actor even has an odd accent, even if they're understandable, like actors from Taiwan, they speak Mandarin, but they speak it with the Taiwanese accent. When they show those movies in mainland China, they will dub it over in like a Beijing style generic Mandarin accent. So they do this, and in schools, all schools, they're supposed to be speaking Mandarin, not dialect. And in minority schools just recently, now, and this has caused some issues in Inner Mongolia, Tibet, etc., where now what they're saying is that they will learn Mandarin as the primary language, and their native language will be more secondary. So
I see.
This has been a push for decades to get everybody speaking fluent Mandarin, reading and writing Mandarin, because the reality is it makes a society, it functions more smoothly, it's cheaper, it's easier if everybody can speak and read and write the same language. I know Western people tend to like the diversity of language and feel that this is like almost a type of cultural genocide, but most Chinese people point to me and they look at places like India and they say that this is not optimum either. So when you have large areas of the population that, for example, in southern India, I work with many people in southern India who don't speak Hindi and have no interest in learning Hindi. For example, in China, they think that this type of thing is just, for society, it causes fractures in society and costs costs to the government. It's just not worth it.
Well, let me talk about another fracture. So actually, I do want to mention, my understanding is one of the issues with Uyghur nationalism and Uyghur separatism is the push for Mandarin on Uyghur children, because it alienates them from Uyghur cultural identity, because I mean they don't have access to the Uyghur language anymore besides like as a kitchen language, right?
Right, right. So that means that they won't be able to understand more complex poetry, which is really a big thing in Uyghur culture, that's my understanding. I've met Uyghur people, several actually, in Shanghai, and I've had the opportunity, the privilege to talk to a couple of them about these issues, but this was years ago. This is before the most recent crackdowns, which were, you know, even back then people were complaining. And I think from the Chinese perspective, and especially since Xi came into power, there has been, you know, like the Communist Party, they have academics, right, who propose policies and write policies and influence the party's thinking. There are academics in China who have been for a while pushing this idea that this Soviet idea of having different Soviets for different ethnicities and, you know, having different, and those Soviets have their own kind of autonomy within the larger country. They're thinking that this is bad. And it basically what they're looking at is what happened with the Soviet Union in 89 and how it broke apart because of that. So, and I think this is basically like a fifth column that these ethnic groups can be potentially used against the central government by foreign intelligence agencies, etc., or terrorist group organizations. transnational terrorist organizations. So their attitude now, and since she came into power, Xi Jinping came into power, is that they want one China, one, I won't say one ethnicity because they would never say that, but what they're saying is basically one cultural norm. So that means in this situation, what they want, at least my interpretation is, they want there to be Tibetans and Uyghurs who are Tibetans and Uyghurs in name only. And there's a good example of this in China with ethnic Koreans. Most of them, because their culture is, the cultural distance is much less to Han Chinese. A lot of the Koreans now are just becoming completely assimilated into Chinese culture. A lot of young people don't speak Korean much anymore or very well. This wasn't forced by the government. This is a natural process, but I think the government wants to speed this along or, you know, incentivize other minority groups to be just like that.
Well, So I guess I'm curious then, I know that the Manchus have pretty much disappeared in that way. I mean, they still exist on paper, but they've been totally sinicized where there's no distinction, right? You get some privileges, some benefits if you're a minority. So some people have rediscovered they are Manchu princesses in China. So let me ask you, I read last year. Well, a year and a half ago now, during the beginning of COVID, I read The Souls of China, The Return of Religion After Mao, and it just talks about, you know, various attempts at liberalization and here and there, and that, like, in the 2000s, the regime was seen to be, like, more pro-Christian, but now it's not as pro-Christian, and maybe it's more pro-Buddhist. Obviously, China is still a communist state. It takes a dim view of religion. But do you have any impressions on religion in China and what people think and how they're practicing or experimenting with it?
Yeah, a little bit. Just for your listeners real quick, when I was talking about the policies around minorities, they might want to look into academics at, like, Tsinghua University, like Hu Anggang, and also another who is not related, Hu Lianhe. These are the people pushing these policies in the Communist Party. But getting back to your question, as far as religion, I think my impression of religion in China is always like this. Officially, the party, being officially communist, although pretty much in name only, I mean, I feel that they're pretty much a nationalist party, almost fascist. Not fascist as a Nazi fascist in the traditional sense, but we can talk about that later. But because they're still claiming to be communist, religion, you know, is bad. It's taboo for a party member. However, for the general public, what seemed to have happened is that we can debate if Confucianism is really a religion or not, although it doesn't have, like, a godhead. Many people in China treat it as almost like another religion. They go to Confucianist temples and pray to Confucius, to their ancestors, etc. These type of traditional, what they're calling traditional Chinese religions, are, if you're going to be religious, then the government wants you to do those things. But the government's idea of Confucianism is basically the part about obeying your superiors and being moralistic, and being, like, patriotic. That's what they tend to focus on. Taoism, Buddhism, although Buddhism was clearly an import from India, these things seem to also be fairly acceptable and get very little pushback. Christianity and Islam have gotten a lot of pushback in recent years. And that means destruction of mosques, not just in Xinjiang, but in areas where there are Muslim, other Muslim groups like the Hui, and they're seeing their mosques destroyed, or at least any visible representation of Islam. So if there's a minaret, if there's Arabic script, that's getting removed. Churches with big crosses getting removed. Those crosses are getting removed, even if the church is still allowed to be there. I think there is this idea in the party, at least in some factions of the party, that these type of religions are not good for China and probably not good for the party. I also think that, so they're being discouraged. I've heard many stories about Uyghur people being arrested because they have Arabic prayers on their phones. You know, Arabic is mm-hmm. the language of Islam, clearly. Mm-hmm. and so there have been people getting arrested just for that and getting put in camps. So I think this all goes back to the fact that in Chinese history, religion was also controlled and moderated by the state, as it was in many European countries, until quite probably until the 19th century. So this is something where the Chinese feel that the government should have the right to control the religion. And as long as you're like following the type of Islam that is approved of by the state, which has edits in the Quran by the Communist Party, then that's acceptable. But if you are trying to practice outside of that, Christianity or Islam, that's a problem. You can see your place of worship get shut down. You can see your minister arrested, etc. Mm-hmm. I guess this all goes back to the fact in China that you can't have another center of power outside of the party. Mm-hmm. And as we know mm-hmm. from Western tradition, religious organizations have long been a center of power outside of the political centers of power. Mm-hmm. And the Chinese government will not accept that. Just like the imperial governments would never accept that either. Mm-hmm. So there's only one center of power in Chinese society. And that comes from, now the party, before it was the emperor.
Let me ask you, before we move on from the religion, we'll close out with some just big picture foreign policy perceptions from mm-hmm. Colin, who, you have a lot of experience. This is why I'm talking to you, because it's one thing to, I look at the aggregate numbers, like I read the articles, but I've been to Hong Kong a little bit, but that doesn't count. It doesn't count, right?
It's different, yeah.
But in terms of like religion and the common Chinese, you know, when Chinese come to the West, they often convert to Christianity or they go to church. It's not a big thing. I've been reading in the evangelical press about the coming Christian China and all this stuff. What do people in China think about this? Do they even know about it? I know there's a substantial number of Christians in China, too. What is the on the ground feel? You were there in the early teens, which is kind of at the tail end of what the Souls of China is saying was kind of not a renaissance, but kind of a thaw for Christianity. I think Hu Jintao, the previous person, he was pretty chill towards Christian. Yeah, he was more chill towards Christians than Xi.
He was pretty much just laid back in general. I think, yeah. I can tell you this for a fact that all the time I've been in China, all the Chinese people I've met in China, I have literally, and I'll expand this to like Taiwan, even to Hong Kong, I've met more people who were, let's say, non-religious or who were practicing things like Buddhism, etc., than Christianity. I can count on one hand how many Christians I've met. And keep mm-hmm. in mind, even mm-hmm. when you see these statistics, there's 20 million Christians in China, 30 million Christians. Chinese people in China do not proselytize openly, usually, especially to foreigners. So in the bubble, I think we all live in a bubble, and our bubble is as big as our experiences. Mm-hmm. My bubble is a little broader because I do speak some Mandarin, but at the same time, most Christian Chinese are not going to try to come up and convert me or anything like this.
Mm-hmm. Well, I probably assume you're American, you're a Black American, you're probably Christian, right?
Right. So I would say I met more Falun Gong people in Taiwan, which is a banned sect in the mainland, than I met Christians. Mm-hmm. The reason you have so many Christians converting when they come to the U.S. is because, and my wife had this experience as well. She came here as an undergraduate, and the Christian church people would, pick you up from the airport, They would provide food, etc., on Chinese holidays, have dumpling making sessions, etc., as a part of trying to get the people to convert to Christianity. And so they would provide all these services, teach them English, ESL, etc. So this is something that these churches actively do to try to recruit Chinese, especially students who are coming to a very foreign country and culture alone, who might need some assistance. And then it becomes a community thing. And Chinese people, of course, are very group oriented and communal. So I would say most of my in-laws who migrated to Canada in the US, they're almost all Christian. But the ones who stayed in China, mainland China and Hong Kong, none of them are Christian. None of them. They're mostly like practice some mix of Taoism and Buddhism. If they only became Christian because they came here.
Well, so I mean, the type of Christianity they practice, are they evangelical, or is it just like kind of like nominal? I mean, you know, because there's some people that are like, yeah, I'm Christian, but they're not like entirely super religious. But I mean, are they really fervent? Is that what you're seeing in the Chinese diaspora? Like, I know statistically many of them do not convert, but people like Jeremy Lin, the ones who are Christian, tend to seem to be pretty serious about it.
Well, yeah, I think it's the same in Islam, right? Most black Americans that you might see in America who convert to Islam are more serious about it than the average person on the street in Lebanon, for example, or Palestine, right? So I think that if you convert to a religion, especially as an adult, you probably take it more seriously. I would just say this. Most of them, it seems to be some type of evangelical or at least Protestant denomination. I know there are Catholics in China. You know, the Pope has had many discussions and negotiations with the Chinese government around placing cardinals or priests in China, etc. So there is a Catholic population, but the very vast majority are Protestant sects, which makes it harder to control because, you know, Protestant sects spring up all the time and branch out. And some of these are really non-denominational. It's just in somebody's house, you know, where they hold prayer groups or Bible study. You know, this is kind of what the take I've seen or what I've been told by people, but I haven't experienced this myself. I usually tell people I'm agnostic, but I'm functionally an atheist, so I don't tend to go looking for religious communities. Typically, but that's been my impression and my coincidental.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm asking this because partly, like, you're right. Like, I mean, I think a lot of people encounter Chinese, you know, in America, you know, Chinese in America, and a lot of them are Christian, some of them are evangelical, and you get, you know, there's frankly, like, I'm going to be honest, a propaganda from the evangelical Protestant press that's been going on for a century about how China is going to be Christian in 20 or 30 years, or there's going to be hundreds and hundreds of millions of Christians. But I actually looked back. They've been writing this since the early 1980s in the U.S. You know, they were writing in the 19th century, too.
I think if you can use Taiwan as a – or even Singapore, but I would say Taiwan as a good example, like a microcosm of Chinese society. They've been exposed heavily. They're a small island. Not even 25 million people, I don't believe, or around that. And they have been heavily influenced by the United States and Japan, but especially the United States after World War II. I believe Christians there are about 20% of the population, maybe, like right now.
And Taiwan, Taiwan is 5.86 or 6%.
Oh, 6%. Okay. So there are the most Christians you have in East.
In Singapore it's closer to 20. I think it's 18.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I think I'm flipping it. Yeah. And so, you know, you have places like in South Korea where it's probably 40-50%, or the Philippines, which was controlled by the Spanish for hundreds of years. But in East Asia specifically, in Chinese culture, I have a very hard time believing that Christianity is ever going to be like a majority population in mainland China, at least in our lifetime. I can't see it. I just I can't see it. I think that they're, I just feel like this type of monotheist belief structure, there's something about it that I think is not appealing to the majority of Chinese people. That's just my impression. Mm-hmm. I just think it seems too structured for them. You know.
Well, so let's close. I want to close out with some big picture. So, you know, you mentioned this. Your wife is Chinese. She's an immigrant, right? She grew up in Guangdong, or you know, so her family's there. You know, you're connected to China in a very concrete way. But I mean, she's connected to the United States. Obviously, she lives in the United States. China, say like 2010, we still had. I mean, I think a lot of people, including me, had an idealism about Chimerica and the future. We could just focus on trade and capitalism and all this great power crap from the 19th century and early. You know, people didn't talk too much about the Thucydides trap, right? Which is like the rise of a great power and the decline of the other of the other power. Let's just say I got woke to the China issue during COVID-19, partly because, you know, I am not happy with the way the Chinese government controlled it. I'm glad that they've controlled it for themselves. I'm glad that I'm, you know, as a human being, I'm glad that they have a system of control. Whatever ethical issues I have with some of the harshness. I mean, again, they've clamped down on the Delta wave. They do have a widespread vaccination, even though the Chinese vaccine isn't entirely efficacious. It's better than nothing. And I think that that's really helped. Them clamped down on COVID combined with their social controls. But, you know, they also control the information coming out, the issues of like whether it was leaked from the lab or whether it's from a natural spillover. All these things are extremely difficult because of the way the Chinese government behaved. I can tell you, I have friends in India who are like enraged at China because, you know, they're like, you unleashed this on the world and you're not really taking any responsibility. So there's a lot of stuff going on there. And I think over the last couple of years, like Trump really changed the perception, and Biden's not going back to the old ways of, you know, China, USA brothers or whatever the whatever we're supposed to be, you know. Now it's, you know, they are the great rival now. And I think that's how they view themselves. What is your expectation in the next generation? I don't personally expect, for example, a new Cold War. In the way that we had with the Soviets, because I don't think that they want a hot war. What I think is they want access and control to resources, and they're going to set up the political, social arrangements in the rest of the world to the best of their abilities to make sure that they have resource access to food, access to mineral resources for their manufacturing, and they're not going to play on America's terms all the time. I think that's the fundamental issue. The game is not set up by our rules anymore. It's up in the air, depending on which country you are and whether you want to tilt to the U.S. and the Western bloc, or to China. I mean, that's what it seems like it's going to be.
I agree with most of that. As far as going back to COVID, I think that the fundamental issue that anyone will have, including the WHO, is that China's default. When I say China, I should say specifically the Communist Party's default is not to be transparent, especially when something bad happens. Okay. So, because a party cannot be wrong. And so don't think that there aren't people being punished over the COVID situation. But that won't be televised necessarily. Because the party can't be wrong. If they can't pin it on one person in public, then you probably won't hear a lot about it, and they will try to change the topic. Because it goes to the party's legitimacy and their power. And they're thinking specifically not about they do think about their international image, but the most important thing is the domestic image, because without the domestic support, they won't be there. Right. As far as like where we're going, right, where I think we're going, I think we're pretty close to being on the same page. However, I would just say this. I think that China has some fundamental problems. And one of them, aging population. Okay, we can use wishful thinking and say maybe they won't need so many people because of coming AI revolution, robotics, etc. But that hasn't come to pass yet, necessarily. And so they have water issues. So you said resources. This is very important. China has a lot of water. but it's been used, squandered in a very bad way with their push to industrialize. And central China, northern China is running out of water. There's pollution issues, clearly global warming, which will make the water issues worse. And so there are a lot of things going on, right? And so what I see is, I think that the government is aware of all these things. And I do think you're right. They want access to resources. That's part of the Belt and Road. They also want a place to, they have overproduced in a lot of areas of their economy, and they want a place to be able to dump those goods. That's also the Belt and Road. They also want markets to be able to sell their stuff to, because they won't have a lot of young people buying that stuff in the next 20 years. So they're taking the gamble here, and they're looking at places like Africa, South Asia, you know, as places of potential markets where there's going to be a lot of young people who are going to be consumers. And so if they can corner these markets, that will benefit them greatly when they're having such a, when they have such an aged population.
I just want to mention, China's workforce is dropping, like its working age population is dropping by millions every year, right? By millions every year.
So. Millions, yeah.
Which in a nation of 1.4 billion, again, we have to keep it in context. On the other hand, you know, excuse me, a one-child policy, a total fertility rate of 1.2, 1.3, whatever. They don't have the one-child policy anymore, but people still aren't having more children, at least not that many. There are these structural demographic headwinds that China is going to have to deal with. You cannot avoid it. This is an iron law of demographics, right?
Right, right. And so that's what you're seeing a lot of. You know, you just mentioned the one-child policy. So now people can legally have three children in China, but most people don't. Why? Because they feel it's expensive. What does that mean? Does that mean that if they have three children, they'll be destitute? No. What that means is they can't afford to educate their children in the way that they think is necessary to have a decent life. And so you see China cracking down on a lot of these things. Like recently, they've been cracking down on a lot of tech companies lately, but recently they've been cracking down specifically on after-school tutoring companies, where they're even saying that they might make them not-for-profit, because they feel people are – because think about it. If you have to spend a large amount of your income for one child to get tutoring just to keep them competitive – that will limit the amount of children that you might potentially want to have, right? Mm-hmm. So the government is highly interested in you know, increasing the population. There's been a lot of talk in China, a lot of confusing messages coming out of the party around women's place in the workforce and women's place in the home and women having more children, etc. There has been there's a lot of things around that, around population. But another thing about control is that I think what China's looking at, and we're going to see a lot more of this, you know, in the last couple of weeks, Chinese stocks have lost $1 trillion in the U.S. stock markets. And that's because the Chinese government has put in all these controls, or threatened to put in controls on various Chinese companies, especially social media companies. You know, like the biggest one being Alibaba. That was the first one that they really cracked down on. Alibaba is going to do a giant IPO, one of the biggest in history, on NASDAQ. And not Alibaba itself, but a subsidiary, Ant Financial. Ant Financial, just to be very quick for your audience, what they do is they provide financial services for ordinary people. So if you want to borrow money, if you want if you're a company and you want to check somebody's credit history, China doesn't have a national credit history institution set up. So private companies are taking on this role. Any type of financial transactions you would think of, Ant Financial is probably doing it or trying to do it. And so they're making money off of this a lot. And the government basically cracked down on them and said, you have to hold a ton of more assets. And you have to basically be like a bank, which really hurt the IPO. And then they canceled the IPO altogether. They basically said they don't have permission to do it. After after the owner, Jack Ma, who's a billionaire who helped co-founded Alibaba, after he made some very negative remarks against the Chinese government for regulating and financial and some organizations. So long and short of it is, I think under Xi Jinping, what you're going to see is that a lot of these things that affect the society, a lot of these organizations, they want control of them. And they don't consider these organizations necessarily big tech companies like we do as tech. When you think of technology in America, a lot of people will say Google, Facebook. China's not concerned about that. What China wants is chips, high-end chips. So they're not dependent on Taiwan or South Korea or the United States. They want, you know, supercomputers. They want quantum computers. They want better AI, etc. So this has almost become like an industrial policy. I think that's where they want resources to go, because that's what they see that they need to, for the future, to be competitive in a space where America or its allies can cut them off. You know, and so I think you're going to see a lot more movement like that in China to, that's the Cold War. That's the new Cold War, if you want. It's almost like a soft decoupling of certain industries, so you have better control, so China has better control over them and the resources going into them.
Let me ask you a quick question. Let me ask you the last question. You know, in the 2000s, Putin, Vladimir Putin, really clamped down, frankly, persecuted a lot of the oligarchs. And in the Western media, this was reported to some extent as an anti-liberal measure, and the rise of Putin's authoritarianism. In Russia, I'm pretty sure from what I've heard, it was perceived totally differently, because people felt in the 1990s the oligarchs were controlling the country. And they're called oligarchs. It's not a democratic liberal system. Mafia and oligarchy and all these things. And it was just chaotic, and the average Russian hated it. So Putin actually became quite popular clamping down on the oligarchs. I've seen some reporting in the Western press that Xi Jinping is the clamping, you know, the control on Chinese capital, on Chinese industry, on Chinese corporations, on you know, mega billionaires like Jack Ma, is actually quite positive, positively viewed in China. And I even see some Western commentators expressing a little bit of admiration in that China is a state and a society where capitalism and the oligarchs exist to serve the country and the culture, whereas the United States, you know, it kind of goes the other way. Like Bezos controls the Washington Post, you know, like all of these, you know, Elon Musk has his own media empire implicitly. You know, Bill Gates is running our public health. What do you think about that perception of what's going on here?
You're spot on there. And I think that how popular would Biden and the Democrats be? Even Republicans are somewhat on the same page that, you know, tech companies need to pay, as they say, their fair share. A lot of people, Elon Musk, you know, people like this, Bezos, are very popular with a lot of people, and they're hated by quite a lot of people. There was a lot of negative reaction to the recent space race we had with, you know, billionaires in the cockpit recently, considering what's going on with COVID. And so if you're Xi Jinping, right, getting companies pay their fair share, controlling these oligarchs, making them serve the people, like Alibaba, I know, or at least Jack Ma funded quite a bit of rural education recently, quite recently, probably to get out of hot water with the party. I mean, hundreds of millions of dollars for rural education. I'm pretty sure that would be popular in the U.S. too, if you could get away with it, right? By a lot of people across the political spectrum. I think that is part of it. I also think it's part of it is this. Xi Jinping has consolidated his power, and he's done that by using anti-corruption policies to crack down on factions that he feels are threatening to him within the party. And so he's kind of doing the same thing with a lot of these tech companies as well. And it's very popular with the people, because it really is cracking down on corruption and oligarchy, etc. But at the same time, it makes him popular to people, but it also empowers him and his faction, right? So remember, in China, the number one rule is there can never be a competing power Most of these oligarchs are party members. Jack Ma is a party member, but, you know, he's a party member in name, but they don't want any other factions of the party or oligarch faction to be competing with Xi Jinping for power behind the scenes. So anybody who threatens that or starts to act like that, they're going to be dealt with. I'm 100% sure of that. I think Xi will not tolerate this the way, like you mentioned, Hu Jintao or Jiang Zemin, they were much more governed by consensus, which is something that Deng Xiaoping before them had put in to stop things from going the way it did with Mao Zedong. So I think Xi is not like this. He's much more authoritarian. I'm not saying there is no consensus building anymore, but I'm just saying that they know there's a first among equals, and they know that there's a very little leash that they have to go against what Xi wants, the core interest of Xi Jinping.
Well, I mean, I think we're going to be talking about, I think Xi is going to be a thing. You know, if we talked about Putin in the teens a lot, I think Xi is who we're going to be talking about in the 20s. I think that's basically where we're at right now. Like, we got to know more about this guy. He's going to be around. I mean, Putin's still around, but let's be frank, Russia is a declining petrostate. You know, it's just,
right, exactly. Russia is like almost like Saudi with much better weapons, right?
Yeah.
And Xi, one thing to keep in mind about Xi is he has not named a successor. He's definitely going to have a third term. It's highly I almost feel, and this is just my personal opinion, the way he consolidated power, it is almost impossible for him now to step down and guarantee the safety of himself and his family. I'm not saying that they would kill them. That usually does not happen. But there have been former leadership put under lifelong house arrest, had their assets taken, et cetera. That's happened. There's been former leadership put in prison in China and still in prison. So those things are real threats. And so Xi has consolidated more power than anybody since Mao Zedong. That is definitely true. However, that comes at a cost. The cost is he can't just walk away. I don't believe that, you know. And so I think he's going to be around for a while.
Yeah. All right. It's been great talking to you, Colin. I really appreciate your insights as usual. I think the listeners will also appreciate it because, you know, you can talk about something and read about it in the New York Times or Wall Street Journal or whatever. But then, you know, talking to someone who has the direct experience, that's important because – a lot of times, I mean, that's what journalists have. I mean, that's their comparative advantage. So let's get as many perspectives as possible, right?
Sure. No, yeah. And thank you for your time, Razib. It was great talking to you again. Hopefully you can chat in the future about new revelations that come out of China or East Asia. I think in our lifetime there's going to be many, many.
Well, I mean, if you're talking about genetics, Colin, you know, there are these preprints. I haven't had some time to work on it, but there's been a bunch of preprints that I need to think about. Part of the issue with Chinese genetics is we know a lot about the present. It's pretty well characterized, but you know, our phylogenetic scaffold of the past is just much, much more spotty than it is with many other parts of the world, in particular Europe. And so I think a lot of the inferences that we make about deep time aren't super robust because they have these huge gaps.
That's interesting. Is that partially due to climate? Why we don't have good sampling?
I don't think it's climate. I think what it is China hasn't been developed with its own archaeological tradition, and a lot of its antiquities,
right.
You know, there's issues of turning them into traditional medicine and
Our Chinese people are unique and did not come out of Africa like everybody else on Earth, etc.
A little bit about that too, but we'll talk about that in another podcast. I'm definitely I was thinking about that. Take care, Colin.
Okay. Yeah. Talk to you later, Razib.
This podcast for kids.
different.